clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Oh, the land of cloudless day. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. A king and his beauty there, and they tell me that mine eyes shall behold where he sits on the throne that is whiter than snow, in that city that is made of gold. Oh, the land of cloudless day. Oh, the land of an uncloudy sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Oh, they tell me that he smiles on his children there, and his smile drives their sorrows away. And they tell me that no tears ever come again in that lovely land of unclouded day. Oh, the land of cloudless day. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a heaven where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Amen.
Amen. Well, this song here, this next one, it's real breathy, if you know what I mean, and we're going to enlist Brother Gary here to help us, okay? Yeah, so we'll blame it on him, okay?
Well, I once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in. Then a little light from heaven filled my soul. He bathed my heart in love, and he wrote my name above. Just a little talk with Jesus made me whole.
Let him have a little talk with Jesus. Let him tell him all about our troubles. He will hear our faintest cry. He will answer by and by. And you feel a little prayer will turn him. You'll know a little fire is burning. You will find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Sometimes my path seems drear without a ray of cheer, and then a little cloud of doubt may hide the day. The mist of sin may rise and hide the starry skies, but just a little talk with Jesus clears the way.
Let him have a little talk with Jesus, let him tell him all about our trouble. He will hear our faintest cry, he'll answer by and by. You'll feel a little prayer will turn in, and know a little fire is burning. Find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
I may have doubts and fears, my eyes be filled with tears, but Jesus is a friend who watches day and night. I go to him in prayer, he knows my every care, and just a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Let him have a little talk with Jesus. Let him have him all about our troubles. He will hear our faintest cry. He will answer by and by. And you'll feel a little prayer will turn in. You will know a little fire is burning. Find a little talk with Jesus makes it right. You will find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Song a long time ago I heard him do this song, and I really like it, so I thought I'd try it today.
Me and Jesus got our own thing going. Oh, me and Jesus got it all worked out.
Have your Bibles with you this morning. Please open them up to the book of Revelation in chapter number 20, if you would please. Chapter number 20. Okay. Amen. Well, I'll tell you what, I've had a good week. I hope you have too. Saw a lot of funny things on Facebook, and I had to share one. I think that's what got me hacked. I don't know. But somebody said, it's day zero of the blizzard, and I've already eaten half of everything I went to store and bought. I don't think I'm going to make it. Well, amen. Revelation number 20, chapter 20, if you would. Chapter 20. Got a question for you this morning. Are you 20 or 21? Yeah. Are you 20 or 21? I'm not asking how old you are. I'm asking where are you? Where are you? Are you in Revelation 20? Or are you in Revelation chapter 21? All right, I don't, I'm not apologizing for any message that I preach, because my messages come straight from heaven, I'll tell you that right now. And if you walked with me for a week, you would understand that they come from heaven, because I don't have it within me to come up and create my own messages. I'm just going to tell you that now. I'm a weak man. I need God. This is a spiritual thing. This is a spiritual thing. It's a supernatural thing. Amen. And a man that gets up and tries to do it on his own is going to fail every time. But I'll be honest with you. I know God wants this message preached, and I don't know if it's for anybody in our congregation. If it is, it is, okay? It may be for a video audience, and I want you to pray for everybody today who might listen to this week or in the future. That's the one wonderful thing about an internet platform, that when you put something out there, it stays out there, amen, until you offend somebody, then they take you off. But we haven't done that yet. But anyway, just pray today, if you would. I don't want to preach a sermon that brings a dark cloud over everyone, but you know what? We have to preach what God gives us. And This was really strange to me this week. I didn't hit my knees one time to say, God, I need your leading this week. I didn't do that so early in the week, and it just like, this is just what God said. This is what you're going to preach today. Amen? And so the rest of it was just, it was left up to praying and much studying and preparation. But anyway, I want to talk to you about the judgment day today. Amen? And it's needful, and we have to talk about it. Let's look at some things. Let's look at Revelation chapter number 20. And I want to begin verse number 10, if you would please. Verse number 10 in chapter 20. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away. And there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever, everybody say whosoever, whosoever was not found written in the book of life, say it with me, was cast into the lake of fire. Heavenly Father, Lord, I need your help today, God. I need your help, Lord. I know that you gave me this message early this week. This is the direction you want me to go. Now, Holy Spirit, I pray that you'd help me to preach in the power of God. Help me to preach this today, Father, that, Lord, Holy Spirit, you could go out and you could convict a heart of their lost state and convince them this day how much that they need Jesus Christ in their life, so that they'll miss this terrible day of the judgment of God. Father, I pray today that you would bless the Christian that is here and listening today by video. And I pray, God, that the Christian will be encouraged to know that this is something they will not be standing in front of, the great white throne judgment. Father, thank you. Thank you, Lord, that in Jesus, there is no condemnation today. And I pray that you'll bless me and help me, Holy Spirit. I pray, Father, in your name. And everyone said, amen and amen. Amen. Revelation chapter 20, verse number 12 says this, and I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were open, and another book was open, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. You know, since the creation of the world, millennials of time have come and gone. After the fall, what began with Adam came sin and war and brokenness to this world. Dreams of men and women have been shattered, and riches have been gained and they've been lost. A great flood came and destroyed mankind except for eight souls, and then a new beginning started, but then sin tainted the world again with the wickedness of man. The Dark Ages came, and then the Great Awakenings came in our history. Empires have been won and empires have been defeated. In our own country, we've experienced a civil war, a World War I and World War II, a Korean War and Vietnam, Iraq, Afghanistan, and many other wars in between. Then in times of peace in America, wars were still raging in the world. And all the time, there are powerful men of the world. They've lusted for power. While they've lifted themselves up with power and the pleasures of life, others have suffered in despair with poverty and in hunger. Man has turned from his Creator and has gone his own way. The Bible said in the Psalms that the Lord knoweth the thoughts, that the Lord knoweth the thoughts of man, that they are vanity. But then, glory to God, there are those who know the Lord and have honored God and have served Him by telling the old, old story. Amen? In our world, there are wars that have been started and finished, leaving many casualties behind. Killer viruses ravishing the globe. Storms of biblical proportions have destroyed cities and taken the lives of its population. Earthquakes have reshaped the maps of the world. Today, the crime wave is so bad in all of our major cities that today it seems as though that the criminal has more rights than those who are the victims. While our stadiums are filled to capacity by people paying a high premium to watch athletes play a game, they're making millions of dollars. The house of God is open free to whoever wants to come, but it seems that we have many open seats left. Amen. Preachers prepare sermons week by week, and they expound on the Word of God with the hope of informing the flocks that they preach to, that they'll understand what the Lord has in store for them and what the way of life is for the people of God. We preach about a heavenly Father that loved the world so much that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever would call upon Him would not perish but have everlasting life. Sermons throughout the millennial of time, preachers have pleaded for men and women and boys and girls to come to Christ and have eternal life. Sermons preached with tears from the man of God with a brokenness, warning men and women about the judgment day that is coming. I want you this morning for just a little while, come with me into the future, if you will. Let's leave this place in our mind today, and let's go to a time that's waiting for every man that has rejected Christ. It is the day of all days that man will experience. It is the day that men of God that have preached about this day coming, but it's been largely ignored by the world. In your thoughts with me today, I want you to travel through time and let's go to a day in the future where the rapture of the church has already taken place. And the world stood by and wondered what was going on when the rapture took place. And now the world has experienced 7 years of what we call the tribulation period. And now a time has come after that seventh year that Jesus has come now and He has set up His 1,000-year millennial kingdom on earth. Now, the 1,000 years have passed, and man arrives at this appointment. It is a day that will bring much anxiety and much grief among men and women and boys and girls that have rejected the love of God and His Son, the Lord Jesus. It is a day that's been ignored by billions. I said billions with a B. It's a day that's been ignored by billions of people over the age of the earth. It is the day that late-night television has written many jokes about. It is a day that many thought was just made up and was not true. This is the day that the atheist has scoffed at. This is the day that the fool said that would not be. This is the day that God has had on His calendar from eternity past. The clocks of the earth have come to a standstill. The busyness of our interstates and our airports and train stations are no longer filled with the sounds of travel. The animal kingdom is silent. The guns of war are silent. The day that preachers have written sermons about this day and they've warned their family and friends, and now their tongues are silenced because this day has finally arrived. Someday this tongue is going to be silenced from preaching the Word of God. If I happen to pass before the rapture takes place, ladies and gentlemen, I'll lie in a grave somewhere and you'll no longer hear this voice live like you're hearing today. All the preachers in the past, I think about Roloff and Hiles and John Rice and Dr. Clarence Doyle and Brother Wilbur Hurt. Those preachers are in their graves today. Their tongues are silenced, but glory to God, the Word of God lives forevermore. Amen. This is the judgment day, the day that preachers have preached about for millennials of time. This is the day that the Bible said the small and the great shall stand before a holy and a righteous God and give an account of their life on earth. This is the day of dread. This is the day of judgment. This is the day revealing the intents of the heart of man. This is the day that the books are opened. This is the day the secrets of the heart are revealed. This is the terrible day of the judgment. In Revelation chapter 20, it was once prophesied, but now it is a day of reality. Revelation 20:11 says, John in his vision, he saw a great white throne and Him that sat upon it. He goes on to say, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away. This day brings such fear and despair. It is the day of the Lord. Jesus said in Matthew 24, heaven and earth will pass away, but My words will by no means pass away. The heavens and the earth have been preserved by God's word, but now the old order flees away from His presence, and now
now his judgment is at hand. John describes this throne as being great, and that's because there's never been a courtroom of this magnitude before. The throne is white, meaning that the court proceedings will be conducted with purity and with holiness. The throne itself indicates the authority of the one sitting upon it. And this place of holiness, the lost sinner will come face to face with the Son of God. As we begin the proceedings, I want to ask you a question this morning, if you're listening. Are you in Revelation chapter 20? Are you in Revelation chapter 20? Is that where you're living today? In my personal experiences of asking someone if they've ever been saved, some have found that to be a very insulting question. It's a question that makes people uncomfortable when you ask them if they're saved. I know that there's been poor presentations by some going out to the world asking people, are you saved? And they look more like fanatics. They look like they're crazy. They look like they're off the rocker more than anything else. But you know what? It is a serious question. And I don't know why it should make you uncomfortable, because you're going to have to deal with it someday. You are going to die. The rapture is going to take place. Jesus Christ is the one that you will stand before someday. And you better get comfortable with it now. You need to research your heart. You need to look inside and see what's there today. Are you far from God? If you're far from God today, you have time today to get right with God and miss this terrible day of judgment. But this question, are you saved? It's a question that others have thought that we are weird and we're off our rockers when we ask. But it's the most important question that you need to answer before you leave this world, dear friend. Another way I could ask this question today is to ask you, are you a Revelation chapter 20 person, or are you a Revelation chapter 21 person? So let me clarify what I'm asking today. The last three chapters of the book of Revelation of Jesus Christ, it describes the day of judgment and then the reality of heaven. Amen? Amen? In chapter 20, we find the last judgment of the Bible. It is called the Great White Throne Judgment. It is where the small and the great will stand before God and give an account for their sins. In chapter 21, John describes the new heaven and the new earth. He sees the holy city, New Jerusalem, a place where God wipes away all tears, and there's no more death. There's neither sorrow nor crying anymore, and there's no more pain. So the question today is, are you in Revelation 20, or will you be found in Revelation 21? As we begin this event at the Great White Throne Judgment, we see a particular group of people there. Revelation chapter 20 and verse 12 tell us who it is. John said, I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. In John's vision, he sees only one group of people standing there. It is the dead. Now these are those that are resurrected from death. They were not saved. Did you hear me? These are the folks that are not saved. They never accepted Jesus Christ's offer of salvation during their lifetime on this earth. They lived on earth spiritually dead. I want to let you know this morning, dear friend, it don't have to be that way. John 3:36 said this, he that believeth on the Son has everlasting life, and he that believeth not shall... I want to say this again. He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. There's a passage in John 3:18. It says, he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because, here it is, because he hath not believed on the name of the only begotten Son of God. In John 15, Jesus is talking about abiding in the believer and the believer abiding in Christ. This means that the born-again believer, Jesus Christ, continues to be in him and living his life in him, and Jesus will never be separated from you, and you'll never be separated from Jesus. That's what abiding means in John chapter 15. The word abideth in John 3:36 has the same exact meaning, except in the negative. The wrath of God will continue, never departing, and it'll always be upon the Christ rejecter. Did you hear me? The word abide means that God will be with you and in you. But in John 3:36, it means that the wrath of God will always be on you, never departing from you, if you're a Christ rejecter. You know who is in this group today? It says that the rich people will be in this group. Now, before you say amen to that, I want you to listen to this statement of what Jesus said in Luke 18:25. He said, "For it is easier for a camel to go through the needle's eye than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God." So let's look at who we're talking about here. We're talking about the rich man. The rich man in Luke 18 is defined as someone who is wealthy, abounding in material resources. Let me just ask you a question today. Do you know how rich you and I are today living in America? Do you know how rich I am today compared to somebody else in the world in a third world country? Do you know how rich you are today living in your houses and driving your cars, being able to afford your gas that's almost $4? Do you know how rich we are today? We are rich compared to a lot of economies in this world. Think about living in Russia or China or in Haiti or in some other third world government today. Dear friend, you and I, we look as though we are filthy rich in the eyes of many. I drive through my neighborhood and I see up to 3 and 4 cars sitting in one driveway today. Amen? You look at some folks in the United States, they have 0 cars. And you know what? Some of us are just blue-collar workers, but yet we're still able to afford a nice neighborhood, a nice car, and go out to eat as often as we want to go. We're rich! Amen. We are rich compared to many others. So don't think it's just somebody that's living a little bit higher than you are today. Amen? It's not some of the famous names that we can stand here and talk about today. You and I, dear friend, we've got money in our pockets today. Amen? We're considered rich in their eyes and in their economy. Those who've enjoyed the blessings of financial independence, those who have worked hard to elevate themselves a little higher than the average guy. Also in attendance at the great white throne is what you and I may call the average guy. But in the eyes of the world, he's rich. This one particular fella has no time for God because he thinks that maybe God would like to have all of his money. Now, dear friend, listen to me today. If you think you're holding out on God, you're not holding out on anybody but yourself. And God doesn't want your money. God doesn't need your money. God's always had money. God will always have money, amen. And he don't need yours to get by. What God's looking for is your heart. That's the only thing God has ever wanted from man was his heart, dear friend. God, if you want to give to the glory of God, if you want to give your money to the glory of God, that's up to you. Amen. That's up to you. But God wants your heart. I hope I can persuade you today through the Word of God to give your heart to him. On that day, standing before the King of Kings, the rich man will come face to face with the one who blessed him with the strength to make a living, to go to work every day, but yet never consider God more than his riches. The Bible said also, John saw the small and the great stand before God. You know, there's many tiers of lifestyles in our society. Some people don't have much. Some people have a minimal education. They wind up with low-paying jobs or maybe no job. Somebody does just a little bit better. They have a higher education. They get a better job. They live in a nicer neighborhood. Many have no car to drive, while others have 2 or 3 in the driveway. Some may live under a bridge or in the mission downtown, while others live in a nice, comfortable home on the other side of town. But you know what, dear friend? They're all going to stand before a holy God and give an account for their life. The regular guy will be there alongside of the most affluent who perhaps maybe ran for a political office. The CEO of a large corporation will stand alone with the factory worker that worked for him. The plant manager will be there to give an account, and standing beside him will be the unemployed. The athlete who is well known and received many accolades in this life will stand alongside his greatest fans. The one who is well known in the community as a friendly and loving person and a good neighbor will have beside him a well-known criminal that everyone was afraid of. They'll all be there face to face with the God of the universe. They'll see his glory and they'll see his majesty. The television personality will be there with the sanitation worker. The mailman will come face to face with God, and standing beside him will be the scientist. The college professor who knew so much will be in awe when they see the glory of God. The honest auto mechanic who served the public well will not know how to fix this problem. The faithful housewife will be standing with the professional before a mighty God. Young parents who are just getting started in life and raising their families will be standing there at the great white throne along with the grandparents who never trusted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. The world's dictators will be there on that day to answer to a holy God for their deeds to mankind. The honest president of the United States who never knew Christ will be there to answer for their sins. It is a day in the future that every human being that's never asked Jesus Christ to save them will stand there different. It's an appointment that you're going to keep. Amen. They'll be there to answer the question, what did you do about my son? What did you do about my son? Dear friend, I want you to know there's no escape from that question, nor will there be any escape from the face of God. The lost sinner will be there to give an account for their life on this earth. The Bible said the books were opened. These books contained the thoughts of the lost sinner, what his heart's intents were, the use of the Lord's name in vain, the lust of the heart, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. The records will be read and the verdict will be guilty. The adulteries, the fornications, the whispers behind the backs of friends and families, the prejudice of others, the mockery toward those who wanted to show you the way of salvation, the revealing of crimes of dictators and criminals who destroyed the lives of others, the secret thoughts of man, the secret conversations, the conspiracies, it'll all be front page news. It is sad that today, with our internet platforms, the news that you and I read cannot be 100% trusted. Amen? Right. It is true that we live in the world of fake news, whether you agree with it or not. Fake news has created so many problems, and much of it has given our communities a lack of trust. Corrupt politicians supporting lies of people called scientists. When the real truth surfaces, the truth tellers are conspired against to silence the truth. That's the world we live in. These will all stand and give an account for their sin. Yes. The conspiracy theorists taking up space on YouTube, leading people down a path of destruction with misinformation. You'll be there and you'll be revealed on that terrible day of judgment. There will be no escape from the face of the holy and righteous God who will bring finality to the wrongful deeds of corrupt men. Bible also said another book was opened. After the books were opened, another book was opened, and Jesus has a book where Jesus has recorded every name that trusted him as Lord and Savior throughout the ages of time. You might say, well, why does this book have to be opened? It's because this book proves that the subjects of judgment are unsaved. Their names are not listed in what's called the Lamb's Book of Life. I was just using my imagination this morning. I was wondering that on that day of judgment when Jesus opens up the Book of Life, this is just my imagination. What if Jesus is opening up the Book of Life and he sees the names of everybody who trusted him as Lord, and maybe there's some blank spaces here that should have been filled in with people if they would have just trusted him. But their names are not found in the Lamb's Book of Life, and that's the book that Jesus will look upon. And that book, dear friend, that book that Jesus opens, the Book of Life, proves that those standing at the white throne are not saved. Dear friend, it's time to consider your soul this morning. It's an eternal soul. The other books record the books. The other books record the works of the unsaved that'll be used to determine the degrees of their punishment. The Bible goes on to say that the sea gave up their dead, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works. What a sad day! What a sad day! No fear has ever stricken man as much as this day of judgment will. There'll be great fear of that eternal judgment. Revelation chapter 20 and verses 14 and 15 are two verses that ought to get our attention for every human being today. It says, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. When I read that verse, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, look up this word cast. And I looked it up, and here's what the meaning of this word cast means. It means to throw or to let go of a thing without caring where it falls. And I thought to myself, the God who loved man so much that he allowed his only begotten Son to die for all the sins of mankind. The God that loved man, even when man was a sinner, God allowed his Son to die for them. The God that showed mercy to whomever he wanted to. The God that gave his grace to us when man still rejected him. The God that gave man breath to live by. The God who the Bible defines as love. The God who was mocked and beaten and nailed to a cross, but still asked the Father to forgive them, for they know not what they do. This God has now proclaimed judgment on those who has rejected his mercy and those who have rejected his grace, those who have rejected his long-suffering, and those who have rejected his love. Now, man is cast away from his presence, and God no longer cares where they fall. Dear friend, I want you to know, when you stand before God at the great white throne, God will pronounce the verdict of guilty. And when death and hell are opened up, you'll be cast alive into a lake of fire that's going to burn forever. And you will be there and burn forever. And God will cast you away. And God will never care again. But He cares today. He loves you today. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. You might think I'm just some big blabbermouth and just a loudmouth preacher. I don't care. Call me what you want, but I'm sounding the warning today. You need to be saved. Amen. You need to believe upon the Lord Jesus Christ today. This is not a pleasant message for any preacher to preach. One of these days, it's going to be no more grace. God's going to let the mercy go. Love will be gone forever. The lost sinner will stand before God and His holiness, and he'll kneel down to his knees, and that'll be the day you'll confess Jesus Christ is Lord. You'll have to explain why you trampled under your feet the foot of the blood of God. Jesus will say on that day, "Depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels." Now listen to me. If you're a theologian today and you've got questions about hell, about if hell's going to last forever, if man's just going to be annihilated, I got news for you. You need to go back and look at Revelation chapter 20 and verse number 10. "And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever." There's no annihilation there, dear friend. Man is not going to just burn up after a period of time and go out into nothingness. That's a lie. And the devil wants it to be a lie because he don't want the sinner to know he's going to have to suffer. Amen. You can have all of the doctorate degrees that you want, but the Word of God is the Word of God. Amen. Now let me talk to you for just a moment. The good news today is that if you're listening to me, that means that you're still alive. And this means that right now that you can escape this awful, terrible day of judgment and the great white throne. Everyone who is judged at the great white throne judgment are unbelievers. Now remember the passage I shared with you earlier, John 3:36. It says this: "He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him." Did you notice that God began with a positive in that scripture? He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. I just wonder if right now, if you wouldn't just bow your heart and say to Jesus Christ, "I believe that you're the Son of God." If you would do that today, would you believe in your heart that Jesus is God's Son and that He died for you on the cross at Calvary? Would you believe it when He was there on that cross, He shed His blood, making payment for all of your sins? Would you believe that He was buried and on the third day God raised Him up from the dead according to the Scriptures? The Bible says if you'll believe that in your heart and call upon God to save you, He will save you, and you will miss that terrible day of judgment. The Bible says it so plainly and so clear in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." I remember the night as a little boy, I got down on my knees and I said, "Jesus, would you please save me?" I didn't know anything about the Bible. I didn't know anything much about church. All I knew was I didn't want to go to hell. I knew Jesus could save me, and I asked Him to do it, and He did. I have good news for you today, folks. If you're saved, you're in Revelation chapter 21. You have called upon the name of the Lord sometime in your life, and Jesus is your Savior. The Bible has good news for you. You are safe. You are S-A-F-E. You are safe from the wrath of God. Romans 8:1 says, "There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus." The Bible says you are now a servant of righteousness. You are made free from sin and you are a servant to God. You have a fruit of holiness and in the end, everlasting life. You have received the gift of God, eternal life through Jesus Christ. Revelation 21, 3 and 4 say, and John says, I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and He will dwell with them, and they shall be His people, and God Himself shall be with them and be their God, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. All must appear before God someday. For those who have accepted Jesus Christ, our judgment is much different. Every life that we've ever touched on earth will be shown how we've impacted them for the love of Jesus Christ. Every drink of water you've given in the name of Jesus, every offering of time and service to God, every way that Jesus lived His life in and through you as a believer shall be rewarded. Shall we fear judgment as a Christian? The answer is no. 1 John 4:17 says, herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Because as He is, so are we in this world. Come on up, Reba, if you would. The believer is secure in Jesus, and we shall be rewarded by the one who died on the cross of Calvary, who was buried, and who rose from the dead. So the question today, dear friend, are you found in Revelation chapter 20 or are you found in Revelation 21? I want you to know you can transfer from Revelation 20 into 21 right now. Let's bow our hearts. Heavenly Father, this morning, Lord, I want to thank You, God, for the message of warning that You have given to me, Lord. And Father, I ask You in Jesus' name, Holy Spirit, I pray that You will deal with the heart that's nearest hell right now. I pray that, God, people listening today would not... I pray that they'll listen to the sermon all the way through. I pray they'll not turn away. But I pray, God, they'll listen and listen and listen and let You speak to their heart. And, God, I pray if someone right now knows that they're not right with God, I pray, Father, they'll bow their heart and say, God, I believe that Jesus is Your Son, and I believe He died for me on the cross to pay for all my sins. And God, I know I've sinned, but I want to be saved. I want to go to heaven. I believe Jesus was raised from the dead. And God, I'm asking You right now to save me. Dear friend, it cannot be any more simple than what Romans 10:13 says, for whosoever, and that's you, shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Would you call upon Him today? God, give them strength right now. Give them encouragement, Lord, to call upon You. And Father, I thank You, God, for the Christians that's listening. I pray hearts are encouraged knowing that we have escaped the wrath of God. Father, we're found in Revelation chapter 20 when all things become new. All tears are wiped away. No more sadness, no more pain, no more fears, but eternal life to be with You forevermore, to be in that beautiful city. Have life and know that You care for us every day. You will never forget us throughout all eternity. You'll never cast us away. Father, thank You for Your amazing grace. I pray, God, You have touched lives today. Father, we trust that You have, and we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand to your feet today? Let's sing just one verse here. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Would you be moved from Revelation 20 into Revelation 21 today?
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.
If you're saved, let's sing this song together. Praise God, praise God.